Okay. The little letter of Micah. Micah chapter 3 tonight. Hi, Harvey. Hi, Barbara. Good to see y'all. Glad you're feeling better. Okay, let's pray, all right? Father, tonight, Lord, we stand in awe of who you are, your eternal purposes that cannot be thwarted or turned aside, Lord. And we look at Micah tonight, Lord, like a bright shining star in a galaxy of darkness, Lord. Lord, we ask that you would truly minister to our hearts and our minds tonight. This is your word. This is your time. You are the Lord God of heaven and earth. And the nations are nothing but a drop in the, just a dust in the scales, Lord. You rule over all. And we thank you and we praise you and we bless your holy name tonight. In the wonderful name of Jesus. Amen. Okay, Micah, excuse me, chapter 3. Chapters 1 and 2, of course, was about the destruction of Israel and Judah, and the reason for it was their idolatry and their cruelty and their turning away from God. As Jeremiah said, they had forsaken the God of truth and the fountain of living waters, and he said that they got for themselves cisterns that couldn't hold water. In other words, they turned from the true God to idols and emptiness and futility, which brought darkness and destruction into their lives. And so that's what Micah is talking about. And in chapter 1, we saw about the judgment that came upon, that would come upon Israel and Judah. And in chapter 2, Micah makes known the oppression that the leaders of the nation was bringing upon God's people and therefore incurring judgment upon themselves. Tonight in chapter 3, the charge and the results or the judgment against the civic leaders and the quote-unquote the religious leaders of Israel and Judah upon their people. And so we're going to more or less, first of all, read through the 12 verses, and we're going to look at the charge and the judgment against the civil leaders and the religious leaders that were bringing judgment upon the nations of Israel and Judah. Chapter 3, verse 1. And I said, "Hear now, O heads of Jacob and rulers of the house of Israel." Now the heads are the decision makers. The rulers were the ones that would carry out the decisions of the ones that made the decisions. They would go into the public, into the people, and bring to pass those decisions that the heads of the nation were deciding, favorable or unfavorable. And so, is it not for you to know justice, you who hate good and love evil, who strip the skin from my people and the flesh from their bones, who also eat the flesh of my people? Notice here, my people. In the book of Micah, the letter of Micah, 21 times, the Lord says, my people. So this is something that God is really keying on. My people. Keep that in mind. My people, who strip the skin from my people and the flesh from their bones, who also eat the flesh of my people, flay their skin from them, break their bones and chop them in pieces like meat for the pot, like flesh in the cauldron. So this is a charge against the government leaders and those who carry out those decisions into the people of Israel and Judah. And this is the condemnation. This is the judgment against the rulers and the heads. In verse 4, then they, that is the rulers and the heads of the people, will cry to the Lord, but he will not hear them. He will even hide his face from them at that time, because they have been evil in their deeds. Evil against who? Against my people. That's the charge. And the judgment is they will not hear from God at all. And now, in verse 5, we have the charge against the religious people, the Judaizers, the prophets, the teachers, and the seers, and what they were doing to God's people, my people. This is the charge. Thus says the Lord concerning the prophets. The prophets were the spokesmen of God who make my people stray. So what they were doing was they were causing, as God says, they're causing my people to stray. And as we look at the book of Micah, what they're causing them to go, what to stray into was greed, selfishness, rejecting the poor, rejecting the needy, worshiping idols, worshiping demons, setting up idols on the high places. They were leading God's people, my people, astray from worship of me. That's the charge that God has against the prophets, those who were to be his spokesmen. They chant peace while they chew with their teeth, but who prepare war against, they prepare war against him who puts nothing in their mouths. In other words, those that weren't giving them anything, they were actually bringing holy war against those people that were not listening to them and weren't giving to them. So it was all about money. It was all about profit. It was all about position and all about reputation. And this is the condemnation. This is a judgment against them. Therefore, you, that is the false prophets, shall have night without a vision. There would be no sight, no revelation, no oracle. You shall have darkness without divination. So they were also divining, and that is conjuring evil spirits, like shamanism. Today we hear of shamanism, and what shamanism does is a shaman and priest will call evil spirits out of the spirit world through a person into this world. And so back then, the diviners, the prophets, and the seers were actually conjuring spirits out, demonic spirits out of this spirit world into the realm of the physical and into the realm of God's people, my people. And so they would have darkness without divination. But you know, I was thinking, there's no void in the darkness. It wasn't just that they couldn't see, but remember, there's a lot of stuff that happens in the darkness. Jesus said, if the light that is in you is darkness, how great is that darkness? It's deep, it's dark. When they betrayed Jesus, he said to Judas, this is your hour and the power of darkness. And so we know that a lot happens in darkness. A lot of evil happens in darkness. And so the prophets and the seers and the conjurers, evil would come upon them, and hardship and destruction, and ultimately upon the nation because of what they're doing. My people. And that's very important about this book, My People. And the day shall be dark to them, for them. The seers shall be ashamed, and the diviners will be abashed, or more literally, embarrassed. Indeed, they shall cover their lips. Actually, the word is mustache. Apparently, there was some kind of thing, cultural thing, about prophets and seers and the way they grew their mustache and everything. And it says here that they would be so ashamed that they would cover their mustache. There would be nothing. They would be empty and dark. Nothing from God. Indeed, they will cover their lips, and there will be no answer from God. Same as in verse 4, they will cry to the Lord and he will not hear them. So the civic leaders, nothing from God. The religious leaders, nothing from God. God is not listening, not hearing because of what they're doing to my people, as God says. But verse 8, but says Micah, but truly, I am full of power by the Spirit of the Lord, and of justice and of might to declare to Jacob his transgression and to Israel his sin. And so Micah says, as for me, I am filled with the Spirit of God, with power and might and justice to declare to Jacob and Israel their sin and transgression. And so we see here in the book of Micah, that's exactly what he is doing. And we're going to come back to this verse because it's very appropriate, not only for Micah and his day, but for us and our day also. And so he goes on, and this is what he says. Now hear this, you heads of the house of Jacob and you rulers of the house of Israel. And this is, now he's talking to the whole group, civic leaders, religious leaders, who are pouring out this abomination upon God's people. Now hear this, you heads of the house of Jacob and you rulers of the house of Israel. You know, as we go through this, and as you go through the Old Testament, it's interesting too, because he's talking to Jacob and Israel. And remember that Jacob, what does that mean? Heel catcher or supplanter. Supplanter. What does Israel mean? Governed by God. Have power with God. Have ability with God. Governed by God. So you see the conflict in the nation here. It's very interesting as we go through the Old Testament there. So you rulers of the house of Israel in verse 9, who abhor justice and pervert all equity. In other words, they turn everything upside down. They twist, and they twist everything that is straight. And it's like taking sanity and turning it into insanity. I think of turning a shirt inside out. They're turning it, everything that's good and honest and true, and they're turning it inside out and calling good evil and evil good. They have no sense whatsoever because God has left them. And so, in verse 10, who build up Zion with bloodshed and Jerusalem with iniquity, or they build up Jerusalem with violence and injustice. Her heads judge for a bribe, and her priests teach for pay, and her prophets divine for money. Money, 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 power, power, self. And yet they lean on the Lord and say, is not the Lord among us? No harm can come to us. Therefore, in verse 12, because of you, wow, man, the Lord says to them, because of you, I don't want the Lord saying that to me. Because of you, we'll get to that. Zion will be plowed like a field. Jerusalem will become heaps of ruins, and the mountains of the temple shall be like bare hills of the forest, and so destruction coming. It's interesting when we, in Jeremiah tells us that when Micah prophesied this, that actually Hezekiah, He heard this and he repented. And the Lord gave time, and he didn't do the destruction during the days of Hezekiah, because Hezekiah repented and called upon the Lord. And Hezekiah actually saved Micah from being killed. In Second Chronicles, it tells us that the nation repented and that God spared them for a time, but ultimately we know that judgment came upon them. And so we see this charge against the God haters, the hypocrites, and their destruction and the way they treated my people. And that's a real key here when God says my people. You know, I remember when we were teaching through the book of Isaiah, and one of the things that God says, you are mine. He said to Israel, you are mine. And so we see here, my people. So going through this, you know, there's just a lot here, and we could go into other scriptures and bring out scriptures and stuff, but I really wanted to key on two things tonight, two very, very important things. Number one is my people and what they were doing to my people. You see, when God gives this to Micah, Micah actually sees this. If we go back into verse 1 through verse 3, where he says, hear now, O heads of Jacob, and you rulers of the house of Israel, is it not for you to know justice? Truly, what does the Lord require of you but to do justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God? Micah 6:8. Isn't it for the God, the rulers, those that are anointed by God and serve God, isn't it right for them to know justice, to be able to discern what is favorable and what is not favorable with God? But they didn't, you see. And instead, what are they doing? They hate good and they love evil. They detest good. They detest anything that is beneficial for God's people. And they love evil. Notice what they're doing. In God's eyes, this is what they're doing. And when God is speaking to Micah, Micah is seeing this. Notice. You strip the skin from my people. Micah sees. And the flesh from their bones. So not just the skin off the flesh, but the flesh from the bones, right down to the bones. You also eat the flesh of my people. I thought, spiritual cannibalism. You eat the flesh of my people. You flay their skin from them and you break their bones. Micah is seeing this and writing it down as God shows him. You chop them in pieces like meat for the pot. Micah sees it. Like flesh in the cauldron. That's how God saw those people doing to my people. How do you think God felt about that? I wonder how Micah got through this and how real it is and how God sees when people are mistreating his people, how God sees that. He sees it really, really, really bad. And actually, when they do it to his people, they're doing it to him. Remember, he said in Zechariah chapter 2, verse 8, he who touches you touches the apple of my eye. Or literally, the pupil of my eye. He who touches you touches the pupil of my eye, says God. Would that feel bad? I suppose that's probably the most tenderest part of the body, is the pupil of the eye. Remember when Jesus was feeding the 5,000 and they're scattered, and he looked at them as sheep having no shepherd, and it says there, and his heart had compassion on them. You see. And remember when Saul on the road to Damascus, on the way to persecute the Lord's people, and Jesus meets him. Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? You see. And so, it reminds me, I had a dream. Years ago, Vicki and I were down at in Costa Mesa Calvary Chapel, and we were in the house ministries, and we were at a place called the Lord's House. And there was about 30 of us there, and there was a leader of the house, Steve Carr, who pastors Calvary Chapel in Arroyo Grande right now. And there was a couple of deacons, and a couple of us were elders. And so one night I had a dream. And so, I got up the next morning and we had an elders meeting, and we were meeting with Steve and stuff. And during the meeting, I said, Steve, man, I had a dream last night. And I said, this dream, what I saw was, and this was like a vision, a night vision. And it was concerning one of the deacons. And his name is Jeffrey Beach, loves the Lord. But he was mistreating the young disciples in the house. It was a discipleship house. There was about 30 of us. And so, and he was mistreating some of them. And so, so the Lord gave me this dream. And there was a conveyor belt. And I saw this in color. And I saw myself watching this. And there's a conveyor belt. And this conveyor belt is going. And Jeff, the deacon, is standing at the end of the conveyor belt. And there's these little baby lambs being shipped up the conveyor belt. And as they get on the conveyor belt, he strips the skin off the little sheep, off the little lambs. And you can see like the skin and the veins and the blood and the teeth and the eyes and the agony of these little sheep. And it's very vivid. And he keeps on doing this, all these sheep, you know, and he's just skinning them and knifing and cutting and shipping them up this conveyor belt. And then the conveyor belt is like this aisle, and off to the right or on this side, there's a bathtub. And every time he flays one of these little sheep, this mature lamb rises up out of the bathtub. And it's all skinned, and it's all bloody. And he takes a mallet every time he flays these little sheep, and this lamb comes up. He takes this mallet, and he goes, smack! And down this lamb goes. And up above the scene is a clear bag of blood and water. And so I share this with Steve, and he says, man, you need to go tell Jeff. Because he knew what Jeff was doing, you see. So this was about Jeff and his treatment of God's people and doing the same thing to the Savior, you see. So I went and I told Jeff. We had a prayer closet in the Lord's house. And the first thing he did, man, is he ran into the prayer closet, and I could hear him wailing in repentance. But the thing was, what he was doing with my people, you see. And that's the thing about this. my people. So he raises up Micah to warn these leaders whom he has appointed, but they are rebelling against him, and they're slaying his people. And they're slaying him, as it were, because he identifies with his people so much and he's united with his people and he senses everything that his people go through, you see. So I thought, man, I got to be careful how I treat God's people. You know, so I thought, you know, our civil leaders today and our church leaders today, how are they treating God's people? You know, one man said, and I've said this before, that there's only one thing worse than a corrupt government, and that's a corrupt church, which is probably very true. Maybe not, though, but as I look at what's happening today and the government that we were under and the things that they were propagating, abortion and homosexuality and transgender bathrooms and all of this stuff, we were on our way to destruction. And I believe that God has given us grace and mercy and another chance, like he does here with Judah and Israel, to prolong their judgment. And hopefully we're seeing these things turned around, because corrupt civil government is just as bad as corrupt church when they're doing this against God's people in their nation. You see, my people, he says, my people. And so he has a man. He has a man named Micah that he raises up. And I love this because right in the middle of this chapter of judgment and condemnation and charging and everything is this beautiful one verse. But as for me, I like that. As for me, I am full of power by the Spirit of the Lord. Filled. The word actually is three. It means to be filled, it means to be set apart, and it means to be armed. I am filled, armed, and set apart. Why, you can see that. And he says here, full of power by the Spirit of the Lord, and of justice and might, or also courage. So filled with power by the Spirit of the Lord, but not just power, but justice. And that means the ability to discern what is favorable and what is unfavorable, to make that decision, and to have the courage to bring it to pass and to speak it out and to declare it. Now also, where you see, and of justice and might, to declare to Jacob his transgression and to Israel his sin. That word declare is also, it means to be conspicuous. Conspicuous and also brilliant. In other words, he was shining and he was conspicuous. That means a couple of things here. In his life, he was conspicuous. He was different than anybody around him because he was brilliant. He was shining. But also, he was making them conspicuous in their darkness, in their sin, in their transgression, and in their rebellion. He was conspicuous. You know, I was thinking about Trevor on Sunday morning, about the truck with that sign on the back that said Misfit. Well, you see, here, Micah was a misfit. He didn't fit into the dark culture. It's like a square block in a round hole. He just didn't fit. He didn't want to fit, that's for sure. But he was conspicuous, you see, because he was filled with the power of the Lord, and he was making right decisions, rejecting the unfavorable and choosing that which is favorable to God, you see. So it made him totally different. But he also had the courage to speak it out. You see, God's man, God's light, in a dark civil nation and a religious nation, he stood out. Just what God wanted. Isn't that awesome? Right in the middle of all this, we see this one scripture. I love it. And I say, God, how appropriate for today. Because we live in a society that's the same today. God has established us here. God has set us here for this time, for this season, for this nation, for this culture. Government is dark. We see a lot of darkness in the church today. And here we sit. And so, what does this teach you and I today? Because we know that these things were written for us. Did not God say, I've written to you excellent things of wisdom and knowledge that you might know more or less how to act and how to please me and how to walk with me and how to conduct yourselves in a dark and evil generation? So this is very appropriate for you and I today. What does the scripture say to us? You see. And so, I think of Ephesians chapter, what is it, chapter 5, verse 8? Or wait. Ephesians chapter 5, verse 11, where Paul says there, don't be partakers of the unfruitful works of darkness, but rather expose them. That's the same word, almost, as the word declare here in Micah chapter 3, verse 8, be brilliant. Micah was brilliant. But he didn't have the brilliance. Didn't have the brilliance of like Harvard or Columbia or UCLA or something like that. No, he shone with the light of God. You see, brilliant. I love that, don't you? Kind of lifts my heart. Lord, I want that. I want to be brilliant. You know, I do. I want to shine. But you know what? I do want to be brilliant in this too. Don't you? Like Peter said, set apart Christ as God in your heart and be ready to give every man an answer for the hope that lies within you. I want to be brilliant with shining with the light of Jesus, and I want to know this. Because I know this makes me full, it makes me rejoice, it makes me strong, it makes me wise, it makes me, it just makes me shine all around and be able to give people an answer for the hope that resides, because it's a living hope, isn't it? A living, bright, shining hope that lives within us. You see. And so, I think, okay, the Holy Spirit, he is a key. He was a key to Micah's ministry and the conviction that he brought to the people back then, and he's the key to our life today. Remember in Psalm 110, verse 3 is prophesied there. God says, my people shall be willing, or literally it says, your people, speaking about the people of Jesus, God's son, your people will be willing in the day of my power. Your people will be willing in the day of my power. If we carry that out to the day of Pentecost, the day of God's power, where Jesus said, go to Jerusalem, wait until you receive power from on high, and you shall be witnesses to me from Jerusalem, Samaria, into the uttermost parts of the world. But wait till you receive power from on high. Fulfilling Psalm 110, my people shall be willing in the day of my power. The Holy Spirit comes, settles upon God's people, and boom, they become his witnesses. Brilliant, shining. You see, same for you and I. You see, in this dark and evil time, and the Lord is near. We know that. We who are in the scriptures and digging and searching and praying, God is revealing these things to those who search and dig. Proverbs says it's a glory of God to conceal a matter, but it's the heart of a king to search it out. So he hides, but he hides that we may find. I think I shared one time before when I was at Thayet Village in Thailand at the Karen Village there. And we were doing, getting ready to do a Bible study one night, and we were in the fellowship house that's in the middle of this village. And there's a pig tied to a post right outside of the house there. And this pig is digging for food, for roots. And it's like the Lord said, that's what I want you to do. I want you to dig, 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 dig. And that's how God's people need to be. And if we do, then we will find those hidden treasures that God has hidden here for you and I to search it out. You see, isn't that wonderful? So, brothers and sisters, brilliant. In Philippians chapter 2, verses 14 through 16, he says, do all things without complaining and disputing. Oh, what do we see out there today? Oh, man. Complaining? Disputing? You and I do all things without complaining and disputing, that you may become blameless and harmless children of God without fault in the midst of a crooked and perverse generation, notice this, among whom you shine as lights in the cosmos. If there were no stars in the cosmos, what would it look like? Black, absolute darkness. If you and I were not here, this country would look like absolute darkness. Hate, hate, hate. You see, so we're told to shine as lights in the cosmos. That word shine, be brilliant, be brilliant. Be brilliant, body, soul, and spirit. Be brilliant in your inner man. Be brilliant in your mind and your thoughts. We are a community that is set apart from the world. We are a university. And this is our library. You see. Look at the universities out there today and what they're teaching. Look at UC Irvine just recently. Was it UC Irvine? Where they had that big Berkeley. Look at Berkeley. Look at all these places, these universities. We are a university. God's university. And the Lord Jesus is the headmaster, you see. And this is his book, you see, for you and I. Holding forth, verse 16 of Philippians chapter 2, holding fast the word of life. Holding fast the word of life. So that I may rejoice in the day of Christ, that I have not run in vain, nor labored in vain. You see, we are Micahs today. We are Micahs today. I got one more scripture. Romans chapter 13. Very appropriate for today. Romans chapter 13, verses 12 through 14. The night is far spent. That word, far spent, actually means advancing. The night is advancing. The word also means to make progress. The night is progressing. What is the left and the liberals? What do they call themselves? Progressives. Interesting, huh? The night is progressive. The day is at hand. Praise God. Because the more the night progresses, the nearer the day of the Lord draws. What a hope. What glorious, glorious testimony. And so, therefore, let us cast off the works of darkness, hate, bigotry, all the stuff that you see today. Remember that Jesus said, he who hates his brother walks in darkness. The hate and all the stuff that is, you know, that word, you could make that word a barrel, and you can stuff a lot of terrible stuff in that barrel. And that's what's happening today. You see? And so, let us cast off that stuff and let us put on the armor of light. The armor of light, hope and joy and peace and kindness and gentleness and meekness and self-control and the armor of righteousness on the right hand, on the left, and armoring ourselves with the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, the word of God and the belt of truth and the shoes of preparation of the gospel of peace. These things, you see, oh, what an armory we have in this university. Isn't that wonderful? And let us walk properly as in the day and not in revelry. See any revelry lately? The streets are full of it. And drunkenness, debauchery, not in lewdness and lust, not in strife and envy. This describes everything that's happening around us today. And we are Micahs. We should be Micahs. We should be Micahs. But put on, finally, ultimately, chiefly, put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for the flesh to fulfill its lusts. Put on the Lord Jesus. Be filled with the Spirit of God. He is a key to you and I and our walk. He is key. The Holy Spirit. And so I wanted to end with that tonight. These two things. My people. My people. And our communion with him in being a testimony and being a witness and being brilliant in a dark, dark cosmos all around us. and in fellowship with one another in the church of Jesus Christ, in the power of the Holy Spirit. And if you tonight do not know without a shadow of doubt that you, if you do not know that you are filled with the Spirit of God, then get filled tonight, because He delights in filling you with His Holy Spirit. Remember, Jesus gave us the story. If a son comes to his father and says, "Father, man, I need a peanut butter sandwich." Father's not going to slap a rock and two pieces of bread and say, "Here." No, he's going to give his son what he desires. And he says, "How much more will your heavenly Father not give the Holy Spirit for those who ask?" How much more? So if you know, if you don't know if you're filled, ask your Father tonight while we're sitting here, while we're taking communion. You know what? A couple of us, Zane and I, we'll sit in back there. And if anybody wants to come back for prayer and you want to be filled with the Spirit, we'll be back there and we'll pray with you. And we'll get, you know, let's get filled with the Spirit tonight. Because He's key. Amen? So, Father, we thank You. We thank You for these words, Lord. We thank You for Micah. Lord, this Micah of Moresheth, common man, yet brilliant. We thank You for his testimony. We thank You for this word for us tonight. And Lord, tonight, as we sit before You now and come to the table of the Lord and partake of this bread and this wine, as it were, Lord, that represents, truly represents the body and the blood of Jesus given for us. As we do this tonight, Father, may we search our hearts. And if there's anything that would keep us tonight from being filled with Your Spirit, Lord God, would You show us that and bring us to a repentance tonight, Lord, and fill us with Your Spirit, Lord God. And so we offer this time into Your hands, Lord Jesus, because we want to shine for You, by You, through You, in You, and for You. And we ask it in Your precious name. Amen. Okay.